Is it what Chrissy? Or Tall Gracie? Or what type of Chrissy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, trading looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our ministry to disrepute. I said, oh, hell
on Cold Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we'll bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody has your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
You're welcome back, and you're still on to Core TV News in Lagos. Our program today is Core Digest, and we're looking at the Lassa fever outbreak. How prepared are we? I've now been joined by Dr. Segun Akinwotu, who is the second vice chairman, Nigerian Medical Association, and a senior registrar with a neuropsychiatric hospital in Yaba. You're welcome, Segun.
Thank you very much.
I know it's not the first time you're joining us on Core Digest. Remember during the outbreak of the Ebola and even one case of Lassa fever, you were here?
Yes, sir, last year.
All right.
Yes.
Now, this disease or pandemic has reared its ugly head again, and it's quite worrisome with over 40 people dead and claiming one of your members in River State. You know, the high and mighty Lassa fever doesn't recognize them.
Yes, it has no predilection for any social status. It affects anybody regardless of your social status and your religion or culture.
And when we look at the history of the outbreak in 1969 in a small town called Lassa in Borno State and the rest, it does not look as if the people, you know, in Nigeria have learned so much from, you know, the rodents carrying this disease, particularly in our hygienic composition.
Thank you very much. Primarily, the Lassa fever itself is an acute illness that is caused by the virus Lassa, the Lassa virus, which is a part of the viral hemorrhagic fevers that we have. And it's also a subset of the RNA virus. Now, you know, generally, viruses do not have particular kinds of direct treatment. So over the years, you talked about we having discovered it as far back as 1969. At those period, I'm sure it was curtailed. And you know, these are epidemics that are not just even restrained to just human beings. If it was confined to human beings, there are measures which are more, you know, developed that we use to confine conditions that are strictly humans. This relates to other kinds of lower animals that even some of our cultural ethnic groups also eat. They feed on them. So that is why it's a bit more difficult to completely eradicate.
Yeah.
Completely. Yes, it's coming. It has come over the years in phases. There are times it goes out of. But from time to time, in different parts of Africa, we have it rearing its head in
Guinea, Sierra Leone, CAR.
So you find out there's movement. As much as we have movement of both human beings and this
animal migration,
also migrates. So that's why somehow it comes intermittently. However, that still doesn't mean that measures can't be put in place.
Okay.
With such a, measures like high level of
hygiene.
Personal hygiene, environmental hygiene, and abilities to ward off the Mastomys natalensis, that's the multimammate rats, which is the major host implicated in this condition.
Is it like the domestic rats or the same rats that some people eat in the bush, you know, in the villages? Are they the same?
It's a species of the rat. And you looking at it may not be able to say You know, the person that is actually going to feed on the rats doesn't say this is the species I'm feeding on. So it's rats, and then we have a lot of poor means of controlling our garbage and refuse. You find out that sometimes in a week, some people still leave their refuse
or in the house.
They still in the house, and if not within within the apartment, they leave it in the compound, a particular section of the compound, and this is not healthy. There should be proper means of disposing of this refuse, because this is what these rats feed on.
Feed on.
And if they've finished the ones that are outside and they know there's still some, the fresher ones are inside, the ones you've just removed from your plates are inside, they still come into the house, and this brings them closer to you. So, and by the time it comes into the house, you don't have properly covered foodstuff, regardless of the foodstuff it is, it can bite it out of your bread, which is already processed food. It can eat out of garlic. It can go into the container of rice, even a bag of rice, and sit there. And by the way, sometimes when you have a bag of rice down for like a month or two, by the time you take out of it, you see pieces of rats inside. So our main means of packaging to prevent these rats from coming to them is one of the ways of, you know, trying trying to prevent it.
But mostly it's the environmental, you know, issue you've raised, you know, very poor disposal ability and attitudes to waste and the rest. And you look around you and there's no area that you don't find one garbage heap or the other.
Yes.
And that's quite alarming.
It's alarming, sir. Despite the fact that the government has tried its best, you see them, local government, erecting signage, do not dump refuse here. And just beside that same sign, you see a heap. Well, we also believe that the government should also try as much as possible to ensure we have expedited means of disposal of these refuse, regardless of what. Yes, you've told us not to dispose it there, but somebody has come to put it on the street. It's not anybody's house. So so far as no one has been caught at the time he was doing that, then there should be an express means of ensuring that it's cleared off, because those are things that attract this kind of animals.
Mm. Now, we've talked about, you know, some of the causes, and the signs too are not very palatable. I talked about the issue of it causing not just nausea alone, vomiting, gastrointestinal disorder. But the one that may worry a lot of people is the conjunctivitis, Apollo. What has Apollo got to do with it?
We've over the years seen that the affectation of the bodily systems is multisystemic. It affects all systems in the body. And
all sense, organs.
Yes, all organ systems. And this, the eyes are part of the special senses that is connected to the brain. So it has a way of, you know, going there, causing inflammation, and gradually progresses to bleeding. As I said earlier, it's classed as part of the viral hemorrhagic fevers. So it causes bleeding in the eyes, the nose, the mouth, and then also we could have hematuria, bleeding from the urinary system, bleeding from the faces too. So it's just how we have even bleeding into the skin.
And the processes of infecting and the rest, we've talked about, you know, the cause and how these diseases transmitted.
Yes.
And we're looking at some of the clinical discomfort, you know, that may arise when one is infected. How about treatment?
Okay, so in summary,
yeah,
I want to run through the fact that the rodent, as we said, is the Mastalensis, which is the multimammate
rat,
which plays in some houses and they live with them comfortably, even though it's not meant to be. And then at the same time, we also said that this transmission is from that mammal, that is the rat, to humans.
To humans.
That's the primary source of infection. Mm. And once these rats play around your food, they play on your bed. They soil the beddings. And if you have some scratches, cuts, that's a means of transmission.
Mm-hmm.
Then we also have secondary means of transmission. That is from one human to another.
Mm.
That is somebody who has acquired the
who has been disease, infected.
Somebody who is infected with the illness concurrently without, starts having the symptom. Now, you are talking about treatment. Take the symptoms a bit first.
Yeah.
Some of these symptoms early look like malaria, look like typhoid. Even some people think it's just flu, influenza. Because you have weakness,
cold,
cough, headache, body pains, fever. And that is how, malaria characterizes. You just go and buy maybe Lonat and give to the person. You are, my son, you are holding the person, not knowing that.
He's transmitting.
This is, likely to be something that is fatal.
Mm.
So that is how, it's highly contagious and could be eventually fatal, that kind of thing. So those are means through which they can be. So that's why when there's a high index of suspicion that this is likely to be Lassa fever, the case must be reported immediately, and the person sent into what we call
isolated quarantine.
The person is quarantined on isolated admission,
and the medical workers
be geared. Take high level of protection. We have some form of universal basic precautions that must be established. They must wear, some apparels, gloves, ensure that the means of communication with the patient is properly, there's proper sterilization of whatever they use. For example, each of those patients must have their own thermometers.
Mm.
And then when you use, because you need to take the blood pressure, it also causes hypertension.
Yeah. You need to check the blood pressure
regularly. So those, you may not be able to buy, speak for each of them, but there are ways of ensuring that properly sterilized after use from the person. And each time the health worker is in contact and before and after, there must be proper washing of the hands.
And that's one culture after Ebola disappeared that Nigerians have thrown to the garbage bin.
Really, I thought some of us sustained it, but I still go to some places, some organizations, funny enough, they still have the hand sanitizers. Some still have, and some still have both for you to wash your hand, but most, as you said, actually disposed of it.
Ebola is gone, which
I think we should sustain.
Ebola is gone, but I have here that the Lassa virus is zoonotic, transmitted from animals, which we've explained, and again that it incubation period is between 6 to 21 days, and that's not far. That's similar to Ebola. So Ebola is majorly, they say, transmitted by bats, right? But when you look at the similarities between the symptoms, the mode of transmission, all the causative effects, aren't we having Ebola on our hands? I mean, without putting the populace in panic.
Well, it's not Ebola. Because, the means of transmission is also from, as you said, from an animal to man.
Mm.
And also can be transmitted from man who is infected to another man. And the fatality rates are almost the same. Because once the person is infected, if proper immediate intervention is not instituted, within 10 to 14 days, the person passes on.
I know that...
However, by the time a diagnosis is made, that is, the blood sample is sent to the lab, we're able to say this is Ebola. We're able to say this is Lassa fever. Yes.
Well, okay. At least I know that the WHO, Nigerian government first, had certified the country Ebola-free, and WHO did same again. Let's hope that this does not take, the deadly turn of the Ebola virus. Over 40 people dead right now. That's quite alarming. That is, we don't even have any preemptive measures when you have outbreaks like this in the country. It's a fire brigade approach.
You see, like I said, it's not as if there aren't measures in place. Some certain measures have not been put in place.
They have the vaccines. I know the vaccine was created 10 years after the outbreak.
What for?
In 1979.
Well, currently in the country, I can't really say much about the use of its vaccines.
Yeah.
But I know that there is the ribavirin.
Okay.
An antiviral.
That's the ribavirin. Yes. Ribavirin. Yeah.
If actually used early in the course of detection, could actually slow down the course of
all those the damages that the
person can actually
recover,
and then the disease will run its course, and the person comes out
clean. Oh, the disease must run its course. For how long are we talking now?
At least within a period of 8 weeks to 12 weeks.
The chapel pioneered the ribavirin is called Joe McCormick, and that was in 1979. Okay, in running its course and the vaccine, it's not something that has been developed, you know, to the level of, say, preventive, but it is just curative.
Oh, well, we can't say it's curative.
We cannot? Yes. So it's a 50-50 situation?
It's not, you don't have
to. Is it a 50-50 situation? Not. If you have to measure it that way.
As I said, if it is instituted early.
Early,
in the course of the
Between 6 to 21 days, the person would have died. It manifests.
That's how long it may take to...
Yeah, to gestation period.
Yes, but if that ribavirin is started early, it helps to slow down the fatality of that of the individual's condition. However, it is not a cure. It's not as if you have malaria.
XYZ.
You are taking Lonat. It cures the malaria, and then the person goes on. It's a viral illness, and viral illnesses, viral conditions, actually are managed symptomatically. That will give them what we call supportive therapy.
If they manifest this symptom,
they are stooling, vomiting, we give IV fluids,
to fever, take care of that.
Antipyretics, complaints they're having, if there's some degree of blood loss already due to the bleeding, as we talked about, if you check the blood level and it's low enough to be transfused, the person gets transfused, keeps the person alive, and then the illness runs its course.
So it's a multi-treatment situation.
Yes, since it's, as you said, it affects multiple organs.
Organs.
So it's, it requires multiple interventions.
So that's why if a breakdown, you know, is experienced immediately, and we're talking of fatality here.
Yeah, yes, sir.
And the spread, you know, has become so alarming that one would look at it from the point of view of management of such outbreaks by government. It's totally not in good taste at all, so to speak. What I'm trying to say is that health management in Nigeria is short of, you know, the standard in other climes.
Yes, we may not have got to the level in terms of technological developments of our healthcare systems. We may not be at that level, but we are getting there gradually. Because in the last few years, there's been improvements in certain provision of some required health facility structures.
At the primary level or at the tertiary level?
At all levels, gradually. It's not as fast as we expected, and it's not as high.
No, not with the kind of embezzlement that we had seen in the country.
Gradually. We know 20 years ago, we know what lawsuit now was
there. Was, yeah.
And we know
it was a general hospital.
Yeah,
then.
It was a general hospital.
Yeah, now it's a...
Even when it became lawsuit, it's like just within the last 6 years that this development started.
Okay.
And gradually, I know more will happen.
Okay.
And then I believe also when we come to the tertiary centers, what the Nigerian Medical Association is talking about now in working with the Federal Ministry of Health is to ensure that we have all required facilities to manage any condition in this country. So those are part of the reasons why sometimes we are loggerheads with the government.
That's why you always go on strike. Yes, why do you always use the strike as a last option, you know, and turn a blind eye to your patients, no matter the condition that they are into, and we record a lot of fatalities.
It's not as if blind eyes are turned to patients. When you realize that, for example, some of these hospitals got deteriorated to the levels that when a patient who is bleeding comes in, you don't have gloves. The cheapest thing you can have available at any time is a pair of gloves. There are no gloves.
And the hospital will not have gloves.
And then
gloves.
The patient is coming in bleeding. Sir, I should jeopardize my life. I'd rather go on strike to announce to the nation that this is what the government is doing.
But you don't go on strike on... You use that as an example, but you've never gone on strike on that. Rather, it is one alliance or the other. No. You know, particular... No. I'm talking of NADS now.
Whether NAD or NMA.
Or NMA, you all won.
Yes, either NAD or NMA. We always try to...
NAD went on strike. I'm sure they are still on strike now. Have they called it off for almost 1 year?
No.
I'm not exaggerating.
No, I'm into the system.
Okay, for how many months?
Last year was just 2 months.
2 months? Yes. You called it just.
It was 2 months last
year. Not delivering medical services.
It wasn't NAD. Don't get it wrong. There were centers where what was agreed on the year before was not implemented. And at those few centers...
These are people that are still being trained.
Yes, I agree. We are undergoing training.
Yeah.
But in other parts of the world, that is what is expected.
Who trains them? The government? Or the hospitals? Or you train yourself? In the United States, you just got back from the U.S. Who trains the resident doctors?
The institution. The institution.
The individual institution.
The institutions.
That is taking them on.
Yes.
So
the institution gives room for you to come for training. Mm. And they ensure that you are properly taken care of in terms of remuneration and welfare. So I don't know where it comes from that I keep hearing that the individual pays for his training. No. I beg to disagree. I have friends there, working there. And I've also tried to. And
other,
I know the remuneration
other professionals pay for their training.
No.
Why must the doctor's zone be different?
$10,000 to $15,000 per month. Mm. That is what the resident is paid in the US. So I don't know where the information came from that people go there and you pay to be trained. Wherever that comes from, let us get it. I have first time, and I know this institute. My friends are paid well. They are still in the training there now. So we should not bring false information to the country. But it's not about remuneration now. The reason why we are talking is
LASA. No, it's LASA.
You see, sometimes when your own health will be in jeopardy, you need to ensure that things are properly done. There was no hazard allowance at some point. Part of the initial strike when there was hazard allowance. When we have those who are not even directly related to health.
Dr. Segun, in other countries,
yes,
when they want to protest inadequacies, they don't go on forever, you know, at the detriment of the entire healthcare system of the nation, at the detriment of the people. They do what they call warning strike. 1 day, few hours. This is to tell you what we're, you know, facing.
As if,
and you leave, and you leave the rest.
Part of us.
No, and you leave the rest for.
You're exactly talking exactly what we did. We wrote letters. We had meetings. They ignored our call for meetings with them. We wrote letters. We gave warning strike. There's no strike.
But the bureaucracy is usually headed by doctors because you wouldn't allow a non-doctor, not even a non-medical personnel, to head the Ministry of Health.
Well, if you are talking about the headship of the health...
I'm looking at bureaucracy now, and it's still the same doctors who are in charge.
It's the same doctors.
Yeah, who are members of the NMA.
The ministers are appointed by various governments.
Yeah.
Last administration had agreed to particular packages. And the next administration will come and sit down and act as if he didn't know anything had happened. Mm. And then when you now try to talk to them, they say they will look into it. What had been agreed not a year or two ago. For example, CONMES was agreed on in 2009. It wasn't implemented until mid-2010. Is that what we're talking about? If the leadership, whether it's a doctor or not, is sensitive, you realize that the minister alone sometimes may not be able to take a decision if it's not properly funded from the budget office or the Ministry of Finance. So it's a general leadership issue. So if the leaders are sensitive to the plight of the doctors who are working for them, you realize that things will flow. Take for instance, a doctor goes to the same market as every other person, the banker, the lawyer, and all other professionals. And if the doctor is underpaid and is expected to give his best to his patients, how do you expect that to come? He works probably a few hours in the morning, 8 to 4, example. Everybody runs a normal duty. Then he now goes to find locum elsewhere to ensure that funds are actually enough to pay his rent and send his own children to school and go to the same market we all go to.
Okay.
If
he has,
so if all that is to happen and the doctor is spending all 24 hours working, how best will he be able to give his skill as a doctor to you?
Okay, Dr. Shegun, let's look at the World Health Organization was informed 4th April 2012 at the beginning when another outbreak of Lassa fever was recorded in Nigeria. I'm sure you were on Core Digest on that occasion too. And we had 623 suspected cases and 70 deaths recorded, you know, from 19 of the 36 states. We're having another recurrence again. Where is medical research, you know, particularly the Institute of Virology here in a pandemic that broke out, you know, 1969 to this time is close to 50 years, and we've not been able in Nigeria to come up with a solution. Yes, you've explained that, look, viral diseases, you know, are difficult to...
They don't have a cure like that.
Yeah.
And then considering the fact that the source, the primary source, is a kind of animal, except you completely eradicate the Mastomys natalensis, that's the multimammate rat, except we're able to do that, which you know that there are a lot of hurdles to achieving that. We need to be at the highest level of cleanliness, highest level of hygiene, optimally obtainable, must be in place. And if you can't have all this instituted, there's going to be a problem. Okay, you drive around from city to city. Let's even agree that Lagos is getting better. You understand? Because the way it was 15 years ago is not the way it is now. You go on the Ikorodu road, then you see heaps of refuse, which are no longer the case in Lagos now. And then incineration of our garbage is the order of the day now. They have proper means of
executing.
And then they try to see how they can remove all these garbage boys from coming to pick garbage on the road from your houses, and they go to the roadside to dump it. And they collect money for that. So there's a better means of getting this done in Lagos. What about these other states? Do they have similar measures in place? Are they also, you know, maintaining same standards of hygiene? Are they serious about the environmental issues and how to ensure that proper means of disposal of refuse is achieved?
When we had the 2012 outbreak, the federal government had responded, you know, so I would I say very quickly, but there was a response, you know, in setting up and enhancing the disease surveillance, you know, for early detection, reinforcing treatment of patients, and on conducting awareness campaign amongst the affected,
isolating victims, ensuring that
We're not really seeing much of that now. Garri sellers, you know, in this part of the country, particularly the one they call Garri Jebu, you know, sales have really dropped because of the fear. Some of the symptomatic causes, you know, how it is spread. You are worried too. You're a lover of Garri Jebu. People are not... you know, drinking it anymore, you know, even in making the hot porridge from it, Eba, is something else again.
No, as you said yourself, the sales of Garri has dropped. The awareness of means of getting food contaminated and foods that are most likely to get contaminated. You see, the process of getting Garri for consumption purposes is what is flawed. we have it sprayed on the ground. It has to be sprayed under the sun, I think, for some days.
But I don't know where they do that. Where I come from in Delta State, in Edo Delta State, it's not spread on the ground. The cassava, the gari processing this thing is probably the most hygienic you can think of. From where I come from. How much cassava are you going to spread on the road, like people say? I don't think that is correct.
We need to factor some, you know, in that part of the country, there may be some advancement in those processes.
The whole lot of advancement, as crude as it may look like.
We have a lot of domestic farmers here too.
Mm.
Those that have the cassava leaves and trees behind their houses, and they do, you know, more of the local farming. They are able, ensure some of them are, and they sell, you know, the small they are able to make is what they feed from. They used to send their children to school.
Yeah.
So those ones don't have that the extensive processes of ensuring the gari is properly done for consumption purposes. They don't have the extensive machinery for that. They live on the small gari they are able to sell. And the way they process is what their great-grandfathers have taught them.
Do you know, let me tell you the easiest way. There is nothing spectacular, you know, about the processing.
Okay.
You grate your cassava, you understand, from the tuberous nature to, you know, a smoothing paste.
Okay.
And what you do, you tie it in a bag, you know, and get a compressor to compress and extract the water, which some people will use again as starch, you know, from where I come from. And that does not take probably some hours, and you can start frying your gari either, you know, the very local way with your frying pan on the fire, and it comes out really good. Or the near modern one on like a kiln or something. So I don't know where do they see where they dry
achievement of health goals.
Mm.
Good, that's health for all, healthy environment for all by certain period is multi-sectoral.
Okay.
Now we've gone into the agricultural sector. Now.
Yeah.
We believe that with proper intersectoral collaboration between the Ministry of Health, highlighting the hazards of certain gari processing practices.
Absolutely.
In certain parts of the country.
Yeah.
If that is actually handled properly and supporting them as the government can, because these are probably people who can't, you know, afford to buy cutlass and hoe. They're not telling them to buy a compressor, as they're talking about now. So maybe there can be a means of trying to do what the banks did. You coalesce the gari makers.
Cooperative
and
societies.
Then they become a bit larger, and then they're able to
afford some of these mechanized machine
processes.
Yeah.
Yes, and then that makes them, you know, safer. They carry out safer practices.
There's no day I'm on this program that I don't mention FIRO, the Federal Institute of Industrial Research in Oshodi. And these are small industrial machines, you know, that ordinarily, like you said, okay, if the individual cannot afford it, cooperative societies should be able to afford it.
Yes.
But I look forward to getting them here very soon to talk about how they are helping to industrialize the nation. Now, let's look at the dissemination of information, apart from the issue of disease surveillance, you understand, which it's active only when you have outbreaks like this. After 2012, after the Ebola issue, after the Lassa fever outbreak too, we never heard anything until it started, I think, in Taraba or Niger State, you know, where the information was not even disseminated on time and the rest. So information management and educating the public seems to be a very big problem with the health sector.
I'm within the health sector.
Mm.
Maybe from the public, there hasn't been adequate dissemination. But I'm sure a lot has been, you know, a lot has commenced, considering the fact that on the radio now you hear about what you shouldn't do, symptoms that they are likely to have, and once you suspect this is related to any Lassa fever symptoms, please do not come too close to the person. Inform so that the person can be evacuated to a safe place where they can be quarantined. That actually is on the news now, and that's from Lagos State Government. And then within the Nigerian Medical Association, we generated a video from the Edo State branch, a video of what the illness is, symptoms and signs, and how it can be transmitted, what you should avoid. And that is being sent, you know, the social media now is, you know, a means of getting people to know things. So it's on Facebook.
The people who are in the villages, in the rural communities. Yes.
We come in gradually to that. But if you think somehow you've been able to corroborate a bit the fact that somehow they've heard.
Yeah.
But they're the ones that make this dairy, and their sales have dropped.
Mm.
And at the same time, boys that are selling rat traps and this rat gum, they are booming. Their business is booming now. And I'm also considering of doing some little investment in that area for this short time.
For the short period, just for the time being. that's the problem, Shebu. That's the problem with the the Nigerian, whether the Nigerian entrepreneur, you get the point. Oh, this water is selling. This is what I want to go into now. And when the man has a little down to, oh, this business is not good. There's no perseverance. There is no continuity,
no consistency.
Absolutely. Be that as it may, I know that sales of rat poisonings too and the rest, not regulated, could be dangerous and could be fatal too.
Very dangerous. Very dangerous because they're very poisonous and a lot of people are not aware. That's why that aspect also needs to be pointed out. Because you have children in the house who don't know what to pick. If it's something that is still nothing on the ground is edible.
There's a particular medication, the Indocide.
Indocide, yes. It's poison, not rat poison.
And humans drink it too.
For some people use that for society. Humans can't drink Indocide. What we have is there's a drug called indomethacin.
For muscular pain.
Yes, for pain, yes. And sometimes to regulate some degree of blood loss in some people for certain things. But it's not having current popular use anymore. It's been banned, I think, because of this.
So
it's no longer being popularly used.
Yes, so the populace would need to be extremely careful.
Those other things, the other kinds of, they say rat poison, but we don't know the composition.
Like the tapiapia that they say. What's the medical name for that?
So one has to be careful. They should people should also be, in addition to being enlightened about the means of transmission, what to avoid, symptoms to watch out for, and reporting early, they should also know that yes, we want to try and
to eradicate rats. But it's even said here that you cannot totally, you know, eradicate it. Because they multiply
so fast, and then they burrow in the soil.
Yeah,
they can thrive also in the bush.
Yeah,
so except you were able to, you know,
clear the forest,
and in so doing, you're going to distort the ecosystem. And you don't want to completely distort the ecosystem without its own attendant consequences.
Oh, yes.
On the
environment generally. Environment. Yes, even on humans.
So we don't cause global warming.
Worsen the impact
of global warming.
In fact, dislocation in its entirety. All right, we'll take a short break. And when we return, we'll be opening our new phone line, which you can get us on. And we'll continue with our discuss on Lassa fever outbreak. How prepared are we? Join us again.
Is it what Chrissy? Or Tom Chrissy? Oh, what type of crazy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, driving looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our ministry to disrepute. I said, oh, hell
on Core Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.